I want to welcome you all here today. My name is Eric Isselbacher. I'm the founder and the director of the Healthcare Transformation Lab. We've started a series of afternoon talks to try to introduce a broader population of MGH staff members to the ideas of innovation, lessons learned, and opportunities across the institution. So we'd like this to be a quarterly innovation speaker series, and today we're hosting the first in that series. But before we begin today's program, I want to take a moment to thank our generous friends and donors, the Novelline family, for funding the lecture series. As many of you know, now more than ever, philanthropy is really critical to allowing us to do these kinds of novel things that aren't funded by hospital operations funds. And we're grateful to the Novellines for their generosity and their interest in the work of the lab. So we're fortunate that Bill and his wife Eileen could join us today. They got through security okay. And so if the two of you wouldn't mind coming up, I'd like to just give you these to thank you for your support of the lab. And Chris was hoping the flowers were for him, but they're not. So it's really a treat for me to get to have the opportunity to introduce our speaker today, Chris Trimble, because Chris has a special connection to the Healthcare Transformation Lab and to me. Just to give you a little bit of background to explain this, for 10 years I was the associate director of the MGH Heart Center and tried my best to innovate to try to improve the way we deliver cardiac care at MGH. Like many of you, I found it challenging, to say the least, to innovate at MGH, and it's not really such a surprise when an institution is already so successful, number one in the country, the leaders aren't always inclined to accept, let alone embrace, innovation. So eventually I decided it would be strategic to acquire a new set of skills to help me lead change more effectively here at MGH, and I decided to enroll in a new master's program at Dartmouth College, led by the Tuck School of Business and the Dartmouth Institute for Healthcare Delivery, called a Master's in Healthcare Delivery Science. The program was enlightening and educational, but I still wondered exactly what I would do differently back here at MGH to try to lead innovation. So it was then that I met Chris Trimble. Chris taught a class about the strategy of innovation, and in that class he specifically addressed the question of how to innovate in an already successful company where change is not always welcome. So Chris proposed a model in which, rather than trying to innovate from inside the performance engine, as he calls it, you instead establish a well-defined innovation team outside the usual administrative structure, one with its own dedicated staff and its own budget. That seemed like an eminently logical strategy to me, so it was based on that model that we proposed the Healthcare Transformation Lab and launched it 2 years ago. And so far, Chris's model has worked very well for the lab, just as he promised it would. So HTL owes a lot to Chris and his ideas. Chris received his Bachelor's of Science degree with highest distinction from the University of Virginia, and he went on to receive his MBA from the Tuck School of Business at Dartmouth, where he's now an adjunct professor of business administration. Chris has dedicated more than a decade to studying how to make innovation happen in a large and successful organization. He speaks frequently on this topic, both at conferences, at academic centers like ours, as well as for corporate clients like GE, IBM, Microsoft, and the New York Times. Chris has previously published 6 books on this topic, a few of which were bestsellers in the business world, including 10 Rules for Strategic Innovators, Reverse Innovation, and Beyond the Idea, How to Execute Innovation in Any Organization. In recent years, Chris has narrowed his focus and is now studying how his prior work on strategic innovation applies to the specific challenges of innovating in the healthcare delivery system. These latest efforts have led him to write his newest book entitled How Physicians Can Fix Healthcare, One Innovation at a Time. So please join me in welcoming Chris Trimble, who will share his most recent thinking on how we can all innovate to improve healthcare, both at MGH and beyond. Chris?
So So Eric, first of all, if there's one thing that I absolutely wouldn't give up among all the things that I do at Dartmouth, it's be a part of the master's program that Eric mentioned, the opportunity to meet people like Eric and to have you invite me down here is a tremendous honor. So I thank you for that. I want to start by acknowledging something somebody said to me some time ago that I find to be very wise. He said, whenever there's an elephant in the room, the first thing you want to do is introduce it. And there is an elephant in the room. I have to confess that at least a few of you are probably a little bit miffed at me already, even though I've just begun speaking. And that boils down to the title of the book and actually just one word in the title of the book, physician. Some of you saw that and your immediate thought was, who the heck invited this guy? All right. So let me see if I can put the title of the book in perspective. First of all, I absolutely believe that every health profession can lead innovation and be a part of innovation every single day. And in fact, we're going to need the concerted efforts of all of the health professions to, quote, fix healthcare. But what I'm going to do with you today is narrow our focus to a particular subset of innovation initiatives. And in that subset, you'll find initiatives that are, A, very powerful, B, long overlooked, I mean for decades overlooked, and C, physician leadership is one essential element in these initiatives. And in fact, the title of the book is very intentional and intended to be a call to action to physicians in particular. But I did say one essential element. And in fact, the nature of the initiatives I'll be describing is the construction of multidisciplinary teams that elevate everyone to the top of their capability. And indeed, the leadership role is often shared. So with that perspective, I hope I am able to keep all of you who perhaps a little bit miffed at me from the start in the room until we're done. I've got a presentation in five parts today, five short parts. Part one is called The Cheap and Curative Pill. Part two, The Climb to the Summit. Part three, Bright and Shiny New Objects. Part four is The Happiest Physicians. And part five is The Prescription, that is the prescription for fixing healthcare. We'll have some time for Q&A at that point, and then I'll have a very brief wrap-up at the end. All right, so let's go right on with part one, The Cheap and Curative Pill. And here I'll start with a very brief personal anecdote. You see, I'm happy to say that I'm a lucky man in that I've been very healthy for my entire life. In fact, I've had but one acute episode, and it was all the way back in high school. My appendix ruptured, and the ensuing abdominal infections were severe enough that I remained in the hospital for a little bit more than 2 weeks. Now, that was a long, long time ago, okay? But I do have a few very vivid recollections. Number one, I can remember exactly what the surgeon looked like. And number two, I can remember one comment that he made to me. He said, you know, Chris, not that long ago, before these industrial strength antibiotics you've been on, people died from this. I was 16, so you can imagine that statement had an impact. I was fascinated by the science of medicine and intrigued with physicians. But I'll tell you, there's one thing I couldn't possibly appreciate in the same way that my near retirement age surgeon appreciated, and that is his perspective on the velocity of medical advance. He'd seen penicillin in the 1940s, polio vaccine in the 1950s, the first major organ transplants in the 1960s, CT and MR imaging in the 1970s. The 1980s brought us stents. The 1990s, we turned the tide against HIV and AIDS in the rich world. And in the most recent decade, we mapped the human genome. Now that is stunning, jaw-dropping progress, especially when you consider that all of that happened in the lifetimes of people that are currently on Medicare. Talk about an innovation story. We've truly lived in an era of medical miracles. There's just one small problem. We can't seem to pay for it all anymore. So I want to see if I can put that statement in perspective with a very simple graph, a qualitative graph. Conversation starter, really. Horizontal axis, cost, per capita cost, how much we're spending on healthcare. Vertical axis, outcomes, Imagine there were one number that told us in aggregate how we're doing in terms of health outcomes, some combination of length of life and quality of life, I suppose. Wouldn't it be nice if there was just one such number? What I'm going to try and show on this graph is the frontier of what's medically possible and how that frontier has moved over time. And I'm going to start way back in 1940. And I'm going to start low and left on the graph, which is to say there wasn't a whole lot that medicine could do for us back then, but at least it didn't cost much. Now, the role of innovation has been to shift that frontier. In the best case scenario, the innovation is like a cheap curative pill. It doesn't cost much, and it helps us avoid downstream care that's very expensive. Such innovations would shift the frontier upwards and to the left. A double win, better outcomes and lower costs. Now, while it's nice to think about cheap and curative pills, the reality is that an innovation in aggregate has not been that good to us. Of course, in aggregate, what we've seen is the trajectory moving upwards and to the right. Better outcomes, certainly, but also higher costs. I've started the curve with a pretty steep slope. Back then, I don't imagine that anybody complained too much about the increase in healthcare costs because the improvements in health outcomes were extraordinary. But what do you think's happened since then? Well, of course, the curve has gotten flatter. Now, don't let this depress you. This is what you see in every single industry. This is pretty well documented. Innovation trajectories tend to flatten over time until you find some completely new pathway for innovation. One sign that we're on the flat part of the curve is a now very well documented increase in the frequency of medical reversals. That's when a new therapy comes out with new research to support it. But then 6 or 12 months later, additional research comes out and says, not so fast. Another sign, I bet many of you can think of at least one recently released pharmaceutical that's only a little bit better than its predecessor and yet costs much, much more. We're on the flat part of the curve. Now, there's just one more element that we need to add to this graph to complete the picture, and that is, of course, the cost constraint. I had a chance to hear your colleague Tim Ferriss speak not that long ago, and one of the first things he showed was a graph that showed the change in the Massachusetts state budget over the last 5 years or so. There was one line item going up, everything else went down. That's healthcare expenses going up, education infrastructure, you name it, all going down. We're at the point now where escalations in healthcare costs are squeezing out spending in other areas that may have an even larger impact on overall quality of life. We simply can't remain on this trajectory indefinitely, and that raises a very crucial question, and that is, where do we go from here? Well, I don't want, and I don't imagine that any of you want, especially at a premier academic medical center, to stop pursuing the next great breakthrough in the biosciences. And in fact, when I say that, you know I mean it, because my own father in this very year had his life extended by a brand new medical device. The solution's going to have to be innovation, but the very first thing we've got to recognize is we need a different type of innovation. That what got us here is not going to get us where we need to go. We need a new category of innovation that I'm going to refer to as innovation in healthcare delivery. Now, on that graph, I've just made a pretty remarkable promise. I've just characterized innovations in healthcare delivery as analogous to cheap and curative pills. I've said they promise double wins, both better outcomes and simultaneously lower costs. And I'll go even further than that and say that these opportunities exist in every medical condition, every hospital, and every corner of this country. And I'm sure that sounds too good to be true, but it truly isn't. The fact is, we've been overlooking these possibilities quite literally for decades. And we've been doing it for very good reasons, or at least very understandable reasons. One is our very understandable obsession with innovation in the biosciences. And there's another, and it's called fee-for-service medicine. The sad fact is that the deal for innovators in healthcare delivery is as follows. The patient wins, the country as a whole wins, and you as the innovator get punished financially for doing a great job. And that's just crazy. And that's why there is no better reason to feel optimistic about the future of U.S. healthcare than the steady and even accelerating transition we're making in payment reform towards value-based payments, towards accountable care. There can be no going back. When the Berlin Wall came down, a new generation of entrepreneurs emerged in Eastern Europe to rebuild those economies. Fee-for-service medicine is the Berlin Wall in U.S. healthcare, and if we can knock that down, then the only question will become, will a new generation of innovation leaders in healthcare emerge to rebuild the system from the ground up? So part two is the climb to the summit. And here again, I'll begin with a very brief personal anecdote. I live in the great state of Vermont, and one of my favorite recreational activities is hiking. And in my neighborhood, that makes me completely unremarkable. What does make me remarkable is that as much as I like hiking, I really don't like to camp. And so all of my hikes are exactly one day in length, no more. That said, I've always had an aspiration in the back of my mind that maybe someday I'd take on a real mountaineering challenge. This is Mount Rainier. I haven't done anything like this yet, and maybe I'll never get around to it. But I've talked to a few people who have, and I've learned something interesting. I've learned there's a big difference between a novice mountaineer and an expert. And that difference in a nutshell is that only the novice celebrates at the summit. See, the expert understands that you never celebrate till you're safely back down at the bottom of the mountain. In fact, the expert understands more. The expert understands that the real dangers are on the descent, because as the day goes on, the sun gets higher and the snow gets softer and more vulnerable to collapse. And on top of that, the climbers get more and more fatigued and more likely to make a big mistake. Experts understand that the real danger is on the descent. Now, there is a summit-like moment in the innovation journey. It's also the light bulb moment. It's that moment when you say, by gosh, that is a fantastic idea. Let's go. Let's make things happen. Let's get it to market. Most companies across all industries, when they get excited about innovation, when they recommit to innovation, the tendency is to expend all of their time and energy and resources on the quest for the summit, the breakthrough new idea. You see, the underlying mental model is if we can just get that far, the rest will be a snap. And in that assessment, they are almost always incorrect. We'll do much better with innovation if we recognize that it is not one challenge, it's two very distinct challenges. In fact, they have almost nothing to do with each other. It's not just about the creative burst of inspiration, or the intellectual breakthrough. It's also about execution, the journey from breakthrough idea to breakthrough impact. And because the climb to the summit gets all the glitz and all the glamour, the execution portion of the challenge is perpetually underestimated. Now, there are exceptions to the rule, as there are exceptions to many rules. And in healthcare, it's worth pointing out that innovation in the biosciences is an exception to the rule. I mean, it is incredibly hard to get to that intellectual breakthrough in the biosciences. If you want to be a small part of developing a new drug, you probably need a PhD in molecular biology. But when we talk about innovations in healthcare delivery, we're definitely not talking about an exception. Here, the ideas are not at all difficult. They've been around for a long time. They've been talked about for a long time. They're very familiar. There are a few dozen examples of innovations in healthcare delivery in the book. And what they say to me is that almost all innovations in healthcare delivery are manifestations of one or more of just four fundamental ideas. That's right. There may only be four big ideas in innovation in healthcare delivery, and you've heard all of them before. The first big idea is standardization of care processes. Now, clearly, this is one we've got to be really careful with, because patients aren't widgets and hospitals are not manufacturing plants. But with that said, there are segments within healthcare delivery wherein the same principles that guided Henry Ford more than a century ago can deliver the dramatic double win: better outcomes and lower costs. Second big idea is coordination of care. You all know very well what happens when care coordination is poor. Some care steps are duplicated, some care steps are missed, patients are confused, patients disengage, outcomes are poor. The third big idea is prevention. Now, I'm not talking about steps that apply to everybody, like exercise and healthy eating, but what has become commonly referred to as hot spotting, which is to say making predictions about which subsegments of the population are at greatest risk of a near-term acute episode and finding a way to intervene to reduce that risk. Finally, improved medical decisions. The idea here is very simple. When there is a consequential medical decision to be made and there is no crisis, slow down. Take the time to make sure all the options are on the table and all the evidence relevant to those options are on the table in front of physician, in front of clinicians, and in front of patients. Make sure that patients have the time and the support they need to reflect on what's important to them and what they value, and the time and the support that they need to articulate what they value to their clinicians, and then decide. Now, I want you to notice that there's no molecular biology on the screen right now. There's no biomedical engineering. These are straightforward ideas that have been around for a long time. And so if you want to lead innovation in healthcare delivery, you don't need a high-tech idea, you don't need a breakthrough idea, you don't need a disruptive idea, you don't need a new idea. What you mostly need is the will and the energy and, yes, the senior leadership support to get started. Part three is bright and shiny new objects. You know, one of the challenges in my field is that innovation is this incredibly broad space that means so many things to so many people. We've narrowed the field a bit by focusing on innovation and care delivery, but right now I'm going to go for even further and try and zero in on a particular area of opportunity. Opportunities that have been overlooked for a long, long time. And I'm going to do that with something of a treasure map. Now, it's not a complicated treasure map. In fact, it's one-dimensional. What I've got here is a continuum of innovation initiatives by size. Small ones on the left, big ones on the right. Size as in resources required to execute. On the left-hand side, you might think about anything that one person can do in their free time, which might be something so simple as somebody walking around the hospital and posting signs that remind clinicians to wash their hands. On the far right end of the scale, you might think of partners launching a new chain of urgent care centers as an alternative to emergency room care. Now, I'm not saying anything about the nature of the ideas on this spectrum. Anywhere along the spectrum, you could have a new idea, an old idea, high-tech, low-tech, sustaining, disruptive, you name it. I've only said something about the size or the magnitude of the resources required to execute. Secondly, I'm not going to make any value judgments here about where the important work lies or the exciting work lies. In healthcare, truly, we can save lives at any point along this spectrum. It is important and worthwhile to say that over on the left side of the scale, we tend to use the label improvement. On the right side, we're more likely to use the word innovation. Now, the boundary between these two concepts is very fuzzy, and I'm not going to try and resolve it. I definitely don't want to get caught up in labels here. From my perspective, these are flavors of exactly the same thing. I will say, however, that there is a very sharply definable and very important transition point as you cross the spectrum. I think of this as a phase shift in innovation. Phase shift is a term I choose deliberately. Think about H2O going from ice to water to steam and the dramatic changes in physical properties as you go from one to the next. Likewise, innovation on the left side and the right side of that dividing line look fundamentally different. And as it turns out, the so-called pot of gold, the big area of unexploited opportunities, lies just barely on the far side of that phase shift. Now, hopefully that's a provocative enough statement that you'd really like to know a little bit more about what that phase shift is all about. And so I'll go there next. And I need to start with our one and only equation today. It's not a toughie. All I'm saying here is that the total resources in any organization, one way or another, through many different processes, is going to get divided into two buckets: resources for day-to-day operations, resources for innovation. One of the most important resources for innovation is, of course, people and their time. And I'd like you to think about that particular resource with me with the help of what I think of as a peculiar pie chart. This really is a pie chart, even though it's rectangular. On the horizontal axis, all the people in your organization, 0 to 100%, and on the vertical axis, their time, 0 to 100%. Now, this pie is going to get divided into those two buckets, ongoing operations and innovation. So think for a second now about what fraction of the pie you think ongoing operations consumes. My guess is that many of you are thinking something like this. I do get pushback on this, but it's always that the blue square is too small. This is the reality, right? So how do we make innovation happen? Well, there's an obvious answer that's practically begging for attention here. That is, why can't we squeeze innovation in at the top of the chart? Now, that may not look like much, but this is actually a very powerful approach to innovation. The basic idea here, or the mindset here, is, my gosh, I have so many talented people in this organization. Let's leverage the insight and intelligence and energy of every single one of them. Let's create a so-called culture of innovation in which everybody feels compelled to develop ideas and even to take some initiative to make the organization work better. This is a powerful approach to innovation, and in fact, most quality improvement programs or lean programs are rooted in the first assumption that this is the only resource that is available. You may have heard the old quality improvement mantra that everybody has two jobs, both doing their work and figuring out how to do their work better, which speaks directly to this chart. Now, nothing about what I'm about to say next should be construed as a message that we should pull back from this approach to innovation. No, not at all. We should keep going after this. Cultures of innovation can be very powerful. But we also need to be very cognizant of the physical limit to how far you can go with this. And that limit has everything to do with the size of an individual initiative. Bottom line, any individual project that is larger than what one person or at most a handful of people can do with their slack time is going to get stuck. Anything bigger than that, we're going to need an alternative approach. Well, since we've talked about the horizontal stripe, it should be no surprise that the alternative approach is a vertical stripe. Which is to say, what if we commissioned a small full-time team for a single innovation project? Now, there are some immediately obvious advantages to doing this. Like, number one, you can suddenly tackle bigger projects. And number two, those resources are suddenly much more reliably available. The thing about the horizontal stripe at the top is that it's not always there. Ongoing operations sometimes are particularly busy and it just disappears altogether, and that can be disruptive to innovation work. But with the vertical stripe, it's always there once you make the commitment. Now, there's a third advantage to the vertical stripe, and it is more subtle than the first two, but it's also the most powerful by far and the most important by far. When you go to the vertical stripe, you all of a sudden pick up a crucial degree of flexibility, a crucial new degree of freedom that just isn't there in the horizontal stripe. All of a sudden, you're able to reorganize. You're able to rethink what each person on the team does when they come to work each day. You're able to practice what I sometimes simply call clean slate team design, exactly as you might think if you were launching a brand new company. And you can do that without breaking anything. Let me explain. very often I get this pushback. Chris, we simply can't go all the way to a full-time team for one reason or another. How about if I give you a handful of people with one-third of their time free? Wouldn't that be good enough? And that does give you the first two benefits. Okay? You have more resources, and they're somewhat more reliably available, but it does not give you the third, with limited exceptions. If you try and reorganize what's going on in yellow, you're going to break what's going on in blue. With this approach, everybody remains locked in to their existing jobs, the existing demands, and their existing processes, and their existing relationships with other members on the team. It's only when you go all the way to full time that you have that crucial degree of flexibility. That is the phase shift I'm talking about. The big benefit is that added flexibility. And when you cross that line to working with small full-time teams, you walk into a whole new world, one with very fertile terrain that's been untapped in healthcare, quite literally for decades. I shouldn't say untapped, but way underexploited for decades. It's important for me to say that a lot of healthcare systems around the country are creating innovation labs of innovation centers of one description or another. And these are no doubt very good things, but they may or may not get you across the line. Let me explain. Very often what these centers are commissioned to do is climb the mountain and get to the summit. Develop ideas, do research, write proposals. They are think tanks, but they aren't designed to be do tanks. They come up with great ideas and then hand them to somebody else to execute or try and squeeze them into the existing organization. It's only when you commission a full-time team for a single project to execute that project that you cross the line into this new world of opportunity. That's so important because I believe team redesign, team restructuring is absolutely at the foundation of innovation in healthcare delivery. We are talking so much about team-based medicine these days, but my point of view is that it can't simply be about exhorting people to work more together. Step one has got to be building better teams from the ground up. Let me return to the treasure map, if you will, one last time. I'm very excited from my travels to be able to say that there seems to be a lot of energy going into innovation anew this year. But I do have a concern, and that is a lot of the energy seems to be going to the extremes on the chart. We go to the left because we're familiar with continuous improvement models. We know how to do that. And then there's this danger that we think, well, we know continuous improvement, now it's time to innovate. And if we really want to be innovative, boy, we've got to do something disruptive. We've got to do something high tech. We've got to do something breakthrough. We've got to have the new wearable device or the new cell phone app. There's a risk of getting lured all the way over to the far side to bright and shiny new objects. I have no doubt that there's value out here, but I will say that these projects are expensive and speculative. We don't know how much value there is. Wouldn't it be a shame if we jumped all the way out there and skipped right over these smaller opportunities that are based on common sense principles that we've been talking about for decades? If we want to do that, we've got to cross the line. We've got to commission more initiatives that take this form. Small, full-time teams for single initiatives to both redesign care and deliver that better care up the mountain and down for a particular patient population. That's what initiatives just barely on the other side of the line look like. Part four is the happiest physicians, and it gives me an immediate opportunity to share an example of the type of innovation that I've just described. And I'm going to choose one from the Rocky Mountains, from Salt Lake City, and Primary Children's Hospital in particular, which is jointly managed by the University of Utah and Intermountain Health. And we're going to talk about, the patients we're going to talk about are children with complex medical conditions. This could actually be a variety of medical conditions. Many of these children have congenital defects. Maybe they have a spinal or brain injury. Maybe they're living on ventilators. Suffice it to say that their families have challenging lives. That said, by and large, these families are tremendously committed to taking good care of their children. And yet, it's very difficult. There's so much to do. It's overwhelming, and often they're faced with conflicting directives from multiple specialists or multiple institutions that are involved in care. The physician you see here is a Dr. Nancy Murphy, who became frustrated with the ways that the system falls short for these families as early as her residency. And when she had the chance to do something about it, she jumped on it. She had the opportunity to create a small full-time team to better manage care for these families. It's just four people: herself, a nurse care manager, a nurse practitioner, and a medical assistant. And critically, because they were a full-time team, they had the flexibility and the opportunity to completely rethink what they did at work every day. And I can at least give you a thumbnail sketch of what they came up with. First of all, in their clinic, every appointment is at least an hour, and many of them are 90 minutes. And over the course of that 90-minute appointment, a family is likely to see almost all four members, three or four members of Murphy's team, plus a specialist or two that may be involved in care, plus a pediatrician that may be involved in care. What happens at towards the end of the 60 or 90-minute time block is that all the clinicians gather for a huddle, and they have discussions about up to four cases that may be in the clinic at any one time. They share insights, they share observations, and they make decisions about how they think the care plan should be updated, and then they go back and have one last conversation with the families. Now, keep in the mind that these families are dealing with a lot. Care is complicated. They may not remember everything they're told in the clinic. And therefore, follow-up is essential. One-third of the clinic schedule is left free of appointments altogether to enable that follow-up. Families ask a lot of questions by email. Typically, Murphy and her team follow up by phone and answer those questions over the phone. They also spend a lot of time continuing to engage with the specialists and pediatricians that are involved in their care and making sure that everybody remains on the same page. Let's talk about the result. It's a double win. Outcomes are improved as measured by family satisfaction and as measured by the frequency of hospital stays or emergency room visits. Costs are down. Total costs, total system costs are down despite the extra that we're spending in this clinic. It's a dramatic double win: better outcomes and lower costs. Now, I've probably presented this example 24 times now, and I must confess that the reaction tends to be muted. And in fact, the very first time I presented this example, somebody did me a big favor. They raised their hand and they said, "Chris, of all the innovations that you could have presented, why did you choose this one? What's the big deal?" You see, what was behind that was a very accurate observation that there's no intellectual breakthrough here. These are common sense principles well executed. And at first I was a little taken aback, and to be honest, I didn't know how to respond, but now I do. I say, yeah, that's exactly right. There's no big intellectual breakthrough here, and that's exactly the point. My challenge to all of you is to judge innovations not by the pizzazz, not by the science, but by the result. Why wouldn't we regard anyone who can deliver a dramatic double win a hero, regardless of the means through which they deliver that dramatic double win? Intellectual breakthrough or not. I want to step back from this example for a second and talk more generically about what innovation leaders in healthcare delivery do. Almost always, step one is picking a particular patient population. This sounds so obvious, and yet it's against the grain in healthcare, where we tend to organize by medical specialty. Step two is to make sure we truly have a firm understanding of the needs of this population. Steps three and four are the truly fun ones. That's where you redesign care from scratch. You think anew about who we need on the team and what they do at work each day and what the care processes are. That can be so powerful. And then finally, measure costs and outcomes and demonstrate the double win. Now, I want to go back to the elephant in the room for just a second here, because I have been asked, can't any health profession do this kind of work, or can't many health professions do this kind of work? And the answer is yes, absolutely. But I say it's easier when physician leadership is one element in the mix. There's many reasons for that. But one of them is that these initiatives tend to change what physicians do at work each day, and sometimes pretty dramatically change what physicians do at work each day. And as one person put it to me, the only person that can tell a physician what to do is another physician. So it just gets so much easier. And that's why there's a huge call to action in this book to physicians in particular to step forward voluntarily and energetically and make this kind of work happen. One of the things I'm happiest to report from my research is that the physicians that are already doing this kind of work are some of the happiest you'll ever find. And I think there's a number of reasons for that. One is Murphy and others know that they're delivering better care to their patients, patients that they really care about. They also may have discovered the joy of working through high-performing multidisciplinary teams. But I think the biggest reason of all is that they have unparalleled autonomy. Autonomy to truly rethink from scratch how care is delivered. Nobody telling you what you can do, what you can't do, what you will be paid for, what you won't be paid for. Complete autonomy. That autonomy doesn't come for free. It never does. It comes with greater accountability. Accountability to deliver and to demonstrate you're delivering better outcomes and lower costs longitudinally. I want you to pause for just a second here and think about a patient population that you care about deeply. And ask yourself, if you had that kind of autonomy, could you deliver the double win? That's what becomes possible under accountable care. The last part is the shortest part, the prescription. And what that means is I'm going to turn to you very shortly now and ask you if you have any questions. The last time I presented at MGH, I had some of the most instructive and challenging questions I've ever had. So I'm looking forward, truly, to hearing what you have to say. One of the important reactions to the Nancy Murphy story that I just shared is, hey, Chris, that's a great story, but that's four providers and only 600 families and fairly unusual families. How do we go from there to fixing the whole system? And it's a great question. You know, in management, we talk broadly and very simple-mindedly about two approaches to transformation, top-down and bottom-up, or grassroots. And in most cases, you need a mix of both. But I can tell you honestly that I've never seen a context like innovation and healthcare delivery where the case for a grassroots approach is so strong. And part of it goes right back to that observation about the patient population that Nancy Murphy serves. It's unusual, and in fact, there's not one set of patients with one set of needs. There's dozens of distinct populations with distinct needs. So we don't need one innovator to fix the problem. We need many focused on unique patient populations. And not only that, healthcare is so fragmented. I've been all over the country in the last few weeks, and among the biggest healthcare systems that I spoke to serve just three or four states. Okay, so we've got to have many innovators across the country doing this kind of work. And in fact, my estimate is tens of thousands of innovators doing this kind of work. Now, that is not an unreasonable number. That's tens of thousands out of a physician population of nearly a million. So we're talking a few percent. Also, tens of thousands relative to 5,000 hospitals in the country. So we're talking about a very countable number of initiatives per hospital. It's a very reasonable target. The role of senior leadership is to create the environment in which this kind of innovation thrives. And that boils down to two big steps. Number one, knocking down that wall. Getting rid of fee-for-service once and for all and moving on to a more sensible model, accountable care, value-based payments. And then number two, to make lots of bets of this type. Bets on small, full-time teams whose job it is to redesign and deliver better care for a selected patient population. Now, the typical pushback here is it costs too much. How can we afford a full-time team? But I want you to see that that is a residue of the fee-for-service mindset. under fee-for-service, you don't put clinicians in place delivering services unless you know those services are going to be directly reimbursed. That's the old way. Once we're in accountable care, all of a sudden these bets look much different. They are modest-sized bets with high probabilities of return under value-based contracts. Think about how small these bets are compared with some of the business bets that healthcare systems make all the time, like merging with a crosstown rival or building a new wing on the hospital. These are small bets, and we need to make tens of thousands of them across the country. What's on your mind? Yes, sir.
I can thank you very much for your presentation. My name is Esteban. I'm a geriatrician here, and I relate very closely to what you were just saying. I run a very small service called the Geriatric Inpatient Fracture Service. Just one geriatrician who takes care of a very precise patient population, which is senior patients who are admitted to the trauma service, the orthopedic.
Yes.
Trauma service with hip fractures and related injuries. And over the last few years, we've seen that there's increase in patient satisfaction, decreased length of stay, basically better outcomes and a lower cost. But we've reached the point that we want to expand our services to other bigger, like surgical services. But
yes.
But it's that same barrier that you were just mentioning about the cost.
That's right.
Basically, yes, we're doing a great service, but you know, the fee for service, well, it's not. So I guess my question is how would you approach in a big institution like this for the great leadership to come up with better opportunities to increase this.
Well, first of all, with sympathy for the people who are trying to find their way to this new world of accountable care, it's complicated, it's scary, and it's going to take time. We just got to keep pushing and recognize there's no going back to the old way. I'd love to see you to be able to expand your program to other types of patients, and I urge you to just be patient. That time is going to come as fee-for-services diminishes and work like what you're doing becomes more obviously the right thing to do financially as well as for patients. I want to take several more questions, but let me ask Julia to tell me what time it is.
You've got a good 7 minutes.
7 minutes. That's time for several more. I know some of you may have appointments, so I understand if you need to go. Yes, ma'am.
Hi, my name is Kanija Arazai. I'm also a geriatrician here with MGH Senior Health. My background is actually working in a PACE organization for 5 years.
Yes.
Prior to joining.
This is the program for dual eligibles, is it not?
For all-inclusive care for the elderly. And then I switched over fee-for-service, which has been interesting.
Uh-huh.
So my question is, are you proposing that the hospital fund small teams?
Yes.
To go out and manage specific patient populations?
That's exactly what I'm proposing.
Okay.
There are opportunities.
It goes back to what Esteban is discussing. We find the same kind of pushback because I think at Senior Health we have a fairly, it's a good construct for that kind of care model for geriatric patients. However, it's always trying to, we have good outcomes and we have good patient satisfaction and we coordinate care.
Yeah.
But we have a hard time leveraging the funds or just
That's right.
the cost that actually, you know.
You'll find if you go to places where I've been that there's always holes in the wall from where I've banged my head into the wall from my great frustration with the way fee-for-service gets in the way of good work like what you're talking about. There are opportunities, however, to get started even within the fee-for-service system. There are holes, if you will, or cracks in the system where you can move forward with projects like this, even under the old way. One of those ways that you're doing right here at Mass General Hospital is working with your own self-insured population, which is sort of a de facto ACO through your ambulatory practice of the future. Right? So you have opportunities like that. If you have a health plan, you can work with that population right away. If you have a population of poorly insured patients whom you lose money on every time they come into the hospital, you can spend more to keep them healthy and still come out ahead. There's probably a half dozen other examples where you can get started under fee-for-service and prove that this sort of innovation is valuable and then expand the effort as the transition to value-based care is made. But believe me when I say I share in both of your frustrations and not being able to move forward more aggressively because the financial incentives are working against you. Yes, ma'am.
Hi, psychologist. And one of the things that I think is really sort of frustrating as well is not knowing how much money would be reasonable to offer for grants in these types of areas. So, for example, Brigham and Women's is doing a care redesign grant. Similar to what you're saying, they offer $50,000 for project-only funding. Don't buy out anyone's time to do the project for a whole hospital-wide or practice-wide thing. Mass General last year gave out three innovation grants at $30,000 each for these grants. Also, no personnel time, project time only.
Can you explain what that means, personnel time versus project time?
You could use the money for anything other than your salary. So you're working the wrong side of that bar.
Yep.
Partners itself also has small grants. They gave out $7,500 to do something partners-wide. I mean, it's complete mismatch of, you know, funds with realistic. So I'd love to, you know, have what you think is a realistic sort of grant for leadership to be offering to be able to do something at a clinic level, like senior health, like they're describing, at a hospital level, like our Mass General ones or the Brigham ones, and even like what you'd think at a partner's level they would need to be committing for, you know, a group of patients.
Well, what is happening now is certainly not a bad thing, and it can help you get started and maybe do some research and develop a proposal for something longer term, and maybe even do a little bit of experimentation to get some data that shows you're moving in the right direction. But I agree with you, it's not enough. To go back to the Murphy example, since it's in the room and I've described it, that's four people working full time. Offsetting that is that two-thirds of the work they're doing, more or less, is still reimbursable under fee-for-service. So what we're really talking about in their case is 1 1/3 FTEs that they need funding for until they can prove that they're actually doing better financially under accountable care. In their case, the hospital was willing to fund them because they thought it was the right thing to do with patients and they had enough of a financial cushion to take the loss in the short term, and because they were very committed to getting ahead of the game in the transition to accountable care. It's still not a huge amount of money. 1 1/3 FTEs might be, depending on who you're talking about, $100,000 to $150,000 a year for a project like that. But more than what you're talking about, to be sure. If we can get to accountable care, they'll prove that they can save far more than that by delivering better care at lower cost. Okay, thank you. Maybe one more and then I'll wrap up. Yes, sir.
This sounds like a field of innovation. I came to your talk, I'm a radiologist here, and I came to your cardiology grand rounds a little while back, and I came in halfway through.
Thanks for coming twice. That makes me feel really good.
Well, I had just emailed someone last week saying, who was that guy from Dartmouth that I went to? So I did. You gave so many good examples, and one of them was that part-timers, you can't expect them to be the change innovators, but you might get them. And that helped. Through that lens, I was able to do a lot of things. But it sounds like a whole field you're kind of in here. Would you recommend a specific journal to follow and get ideas like this?
That's a great question. I recall some news of somebody launching a journal about innovation in care delivery. So they're out there, and there's one about to be launched on the patient experience and innovating around the patient experience that has a similar intent. Suffice it to say that these are relatively new journals. And I worry that what we're going to see is the scientific mindset applied to healthcare delivery in a way that's unhealthy. And I don't know that, but I worry about it. We have a mindset in the biosciences that we need randomized control trial quality proof that innovations are really successful, and that could be poisonous to what we're trying to do here. We need to recognize that these are business bets, not medical bets. We're not irradiating anybody, not cutting into anybody, not ingesting chemicals. We're simply, for the most part, we're simply spending more time with patients and more time thinking and planning. Right? And that is something we ought to be able to move forward with using the standards of proof that are common in the business world, which is let's have a clear hypothesis and then let's test the hypothesis with data and with trends. So I'd like to see a journal that was closer to what you'd see in the Harvard Business Review in that way, where we're not presenting traditional scientific articles that create a false impression that nothing is true until we have bulletproof evidence that it's true. I don't think that that's very productive. Let me close by sharing one more thought, and that is I've talked about the power of the dedicated team, but I confess that's not a full picture. There are always some part-timers involved anytime you launch a dedicated team inside an established organization. And that leaves you with a delicate managerial challenge, navigating a partnership between a group of full-time team members and part-time team members. Doing this well starts by understanding that while you've got, in theory at least, infinite flexibility on the right, you have virtually no flexibility on the left. And therefore, it takes a little bit of finesse to make this partnership a healthy one. That is, in fact, what 5 or 6 out of 14 chapters of this book are about, and what I've been studying for many years before coming into healthcare. How do you make that team structure effective? So I hope you'll take a look at the book and also a related resource, a parable called How Stella Saved the Farm, which is a simple story about a farm in trouble and how it innovates to get out of trouble. Now, in the spirit of George Orwell, it's the animals that run the farm, which is what makes this book fun. Almost everybody that starts reading it is going to finish it, and then they're going to want to talk about it. And these are good conversations for anticipating the journey ahead, the very tensions that arise in this partnership, for example, between the dedicated team and the shared staff. The last resource I'm working on that might be meaningful to you in particular is a new website called The Physician Innovator, which is not a journal. And today it's brand new and not much more than a little bit more information about the book, to be completely open with you. But over 2016 and subsequent years, my intent is to build this into a platform for peer learning. So if you're working on an innovation in healthcare delivery, you can have an easier time finding somebody else in the country who's doing something similar that might be willing to share some hard-won lessons learned with you so we don't all reinvent the wheel from scratch and make the same mistakes everywhere we try things. I'd love to thank my partners back in the home office, but mostly I'd like to thank all of you for coming and Eric for inviting me. Thanks very, very much.